Okay. So to some extent, it continues the talk which we had just from Philip, in the sense that we dealt with the problem how to deal with observations under very bad conditions. And here you see there's the motivation to do moonlit shower maxima observations. The current situation I will describe briefly, some background, how this all works together. And then I come up with an observing proposal. Hopefully some people will participate. And well, let's go through the whole thing step by step. You know that if you look at IMO graphs, the live graphs, you often find things like here with the Geminis in 2018, you have just covered the maximum and something more and then nothing else is available. Or with the Orionids 2016, you have this nice series rising branch, and then there's the full moon gap, nothing happens, and then you have some scattered value until it goes back. So that's very frustrating because you don't know about important parts of the shower activity, what's going on. The other thing is you have, after doing analysis, differences which are difficult to explain. I mean, there are two different types of errors which can affect your result. One is the normal stochastic error, which you can solve by collecting a few thousand more data, but then there are also systematic biases, which we have often, and then it doesn't help. Even if you collect the next 1,000 data points, it doesn't change because of some systematic thing happening. For example, we had in 89, always a long time ago, but just as an example, a normal Perseid peak with a rate over 100. And the next year it was in bright moonlight. First you have less data points, but still covered, but the peak values are 80 or lesser or less. And both were just regular returns. It was not yet the time of the filament and trail crossings and so on. And so there's something which doesn't work properly. I mean, obviously it seems not the case that everything is already solved completely. We have a standard procedure, which based on a number of information we have. So the one thing which is obvious, we have the number of shower meteors. Of course, there are errors in the shower association. This is one of these things you can solve by adding more data points. Then we have the question of correcting for limiting magnitudes. There's a kind of standard procedure, well established. There the first questions arise. How much can such things be affected by, I called it here, other conditions? For example, it's known that if the sky background becomes bright, then you still see relatively faint stars in your field center, but not the corresponding number of meteors. The fact is that all the calibrations or the factors which are included in the calibrations were taken or found during campaigns where we had perfect conditions. So we cannot answer a few questions if these conditions are different from perfect. Next, there's also an error which may affect the population index, which is usually determined from the magnitude data, and which is usually valid for a typical range where it's assumed that it's more or less exponential rise. So it's something between -2 and +4 or +5 magnitude. The other corrections believe out here for the moment, because you know, you could talk about each of these points for an hour or so. So we concentrate on the second question, the limiting magnitude. So what is the case here? We usually do star counts and want to find out the limiting magnitude for an observer. But how much does this represent really the meteor limiting magnitude? This obviously depends on the angular velocity. You know, the eye integrates, although it's no CCD camera or something like that, also over a certain time, which is of the order of 0.05 seconds. And a dark adapted eye has spatial resolution of the order of 7 arc minutes or so. And so this means during this integration time, you have some area over which you integrate the intensity. So the main thing is that the meteor limiting magnitude depends on the angular velocity and of course of the personal effects, the perception of each observer. If we just think about the relations which we face there, we have a sky brightness, normal background brightness. If the limiting magnitude is something like 6.5, so that's the reference value, that corresponds to 21.5 magnitude per square arc second. Difficult to imagine. That's a number which you get from these sky quality meters. I think I have, here we have a graph for that. And here you have the limiting magnitude, and this is this magnitudes per square arc second. That's from a paper of Krume in Monthly Notices 2014. So he deals with also visual observing through telescopes, but the basic things are of course the same. And of course, we cannot see a meteor which is just at the background. So we need some signal noise ratio. And if we assume, just another assumption, a ratio of 5 for successful detection of meteors, this would correspond to a difference of about 1.7 magnitudes to the background. And then, as I already mentioned, the personal perception adds to the whole thing. And now the task or the question is how we find the differences and how we can correct for them if the background changes. Here I have just for illustration also summarized the meteor magnitudes for different angular velocities. If we have very slow meteors, like 6 degrees per second, that's in the integration time of the eye or 100 square arc seconds. So that's the chance that you see just 6 meteors if the limiting magnitude is 6.5 again. And the faster it goes, the less you see of that. And that's, for example, also important if you select the observing direction. If your radiant is low, say for the Perseids or any other shower, but for the Perseids is a good example. That means in the evening when the radiant is still low, the meteors in the zenith are very fast. So they you will not see the faintest ones because of the rapid motion. But you cannot look towards the horizon, then you lose a lot of field. So you have to optimize. It's easier if the radiant is near the zenith, so then the situation is critical. One thing we have also to keep in mind is that there are two different effects, and I want to clarify what I'm speaking about. First, you can have the limiting magnitude be decreased if something moves between your eye and the sky, so some haze or whatever. And that is a transparency reduction that works for everything. So that reduces the stars as well as the meteors. That's not the critical point. Here the correction works well. Here, this is the critical point. If we have this background increase And then we have to think why this effect, as I mentioned in the beginning, happens, that you see still the stars, but the meteors not. This is an assumption or something we discussed, Ralph and myself. If you assume a dark sky, really perfect, you have 6.5 in the field center, and now the moon rises. That means nothing happens with the intensity of the stars and meteors. There's not a sheet coming in between us all. So that remains the same. But the background becomes brighter, say by one magnitude. So the limiting magnitude is one magnitude less. That's for the field center. What happens towards the edge of your field? Of course, you see not the faintest meteors outside the field center. You see them only in the middle of the field. The further you go, the less faint meteors you see. Let's assume that, say, at the edge, it's just 3.5, so 3 magnitudes less. Now with the moon, also the background becomes one magnitude brighter. That's the same, perhaps, in all directions. So the signal noise ratio reduces. But while it is too low in the center for the faint meteors, it still remains high enough to see the brighter meteors far away. So, you know, fireballs are seen everywhere. And the further you go to the faint meteors, which you usually see only near the field center, they are lost. So that may be some clue of this loss of meteors as compared to moonless conditions. How can we access that problem? The classical thing would be you use global data which would overlap. So you can combine, for example, observations made in Europe and North America or from Russia and Europe and so on. So then it means at one location, the moon may be there and the other not, but the radiant is different elevation. So that has also some effect. Then you can access it by using the ratio between shower and sporadic meteors in the subsequent nights, or known from other occasions, so that from the same solar longitude in previous years. Or you can use data obtained by other methods, like radio forward scatter video data, as I did several times in the past. But there are some other things. At least from a theoretical point of view, it has not been extensively used. Janko Richter has suggested in a paper in WGN this year that there is a method to derive the ZHR and the LM correction, which is not the true population index R from one sample. This parameter Q, not R, but called Q, would just describe the increase of the rate with the limiting magnitude. That could be a practical test possible here, or we could also adapt the method suggested by Zoko for the determination of the population index from video data by looking at the graphs of the magnitude distributions and then find the best fit for observations grouped in different limiting magnitude ranges. Okay, so what does it mean for our practical attempt? We need a ZHR for one period with and without moonlight. So simultaneous observations, obviously not from the same location because you cannot switch on and off the moon. And we need large samples for both cases. So that works only for big showers. Possible observing windows could be during major shower activity because otherwise the sample remains too small. And of course you have to make sure that the radiant elevation is high enough for a long time per night. Otherwise you have difficulties or maybe difficulties with this zenith exponent gamma, which may be one or even larger than that. And that of course will only work if it's not full moon itself. Otherwise the whole night is bright, of course. there's the first good opportunity already in this year for the Geminids. We have then the moon 3 days after first quarter. So that means in the maximum night, it sets about 2 hours local time. That means depending on the latitude, about 3 to 5 hours remain dark. The other part of the night is illuminated. And if you just take as an example, 14th of December, 5 UT, still dark, for example, in Europe. And the radiant, of course, very high. And at the same time, it would be before a near local midnight, depending on the longitude. And of course, the moon is then still above the horizon. So that would work even for 120 degrees west at the Pacific coast with the radiant sufficiently high. So that would mean the one group provides the sample with no moonlight and the other sample with the moonlight. But we have the different conditions. The same would work, for example, with the dark sky in Asia or Eastern Russia and the bright sky in Europe. So these combinations can be used or can be selected as possible. Another proposal, which is not that nice at the first moment, is the Perseids next year, which occur really at full moon. So there's no dark period where we have this undisturbed sample, but when we can use both the other methods which mentioned. And so then it's of course necessary to have a large sample. And contrary to the usual guidelines we give for visual observations, please use then also the nights with the full moon or with the moonlight to just deliver data for this project. It's put into the VMDB as usual observation, so nothing special needed. So why to observe? First, to complete the shower activity profiles, and second, to derive the peak data for events, like, for example, also Perseid filaments or so on, and also to improve the value of daytime shower data, which are also taken under poor observing conditions. And then, of course, these two events, which I mentioned. So the next half year may help to shed light into how this problem. And you see, after all this time with visual observations where everybody thought it's all solved, it's still things to do and to improve, and hope many observations as possible. Thank you.